হ্যাঁ লাইভে গেছি, হ্যাঁ উই আর লাইভ নাও।
ঠিক আছে।
গুড মর্নিং এভরিওয়ান, ওয়েলকাম টু দা অনলাইন লেকচার নাম্বার 1 অফ দা অনলাইন লেকচার সিরিজ অর্গানাইজড বাই দা ডিপার্টমেন্ট অফ ইংলিশ, সেবা ভারতী মহাবিদ্যালয়, কাপগাড়ি, ঝাড়গ্রাম, ওয়েস্ট বেঙ্গল। আই এম ডক্টর সমিত কুমার মাইতি, অ্যাসিস্ট্যান্ট প্রফেসর অ্যান্ড হেড অফ দ্য ডিপার্টমেন্ট অ্যান্ড অলসো দ্য অর্গানাইজিং সেক্রেটারি অফ দ্য অনলাইন লেকচার সিরিজ কন্ডাক্টেড বাই দ্য ইংলিশ ডিপার্টমেন্ট সেবা ভারতী মহাবিদ্যালয়। অন বিহাফ অফ দ্য ইংলিশ ডিপার্টমেন্ট আই উড লাইক টু এক্সপ্রেস মাই হার্ট ফেল্ট গ্র্যাটিচিউড টু মিস্টার সুবর্ণ রয়, দ্য অনারেবল অ্যাডমিনিস্ট্রেটর অফ দ্য গভর্নিং বডি, ফর হিজ কাইন্ড কোঅপারেশন, কনস্ট্যান্ট মোটিভেশন অ্যান্ড মোরাল সাপোর্ট। আই অলসো এক্সটেন্ড মাই সিনসিয়ার থ্যাঙ্কস টু ডক্টর বিনোদ চৌধুরী, দ্য ভাইস প্রিন্সিপাল অফ সেবা ভারতী মহাবিদ্যালয় অ্যান্ড অলসো দ্য পেট্রন অফ দিস অনলাইন লেকচার সিরিজ, ফর গিভিং হিজ কনসেন্ট টু অর্গানাইজ দিস ইভেন্ট। মাই ডিপেস্ট গ্র্যাটিচিউড অ্যান্ড হার্টি থ্যাঙ্কস টু দ্য ডিস্টিংগুইশ স্পিকার অফ টুডেজ লেকচার, ডক্টর উজ্জ্বল কুমার পণ্ডা, অ্যাসিস্ট্যান্ট প্রফেসর ইন দ্য WBES ডিপার্টমেন্ট অফ ইংলিশ, গভর্নমেন্ট জেনারেল ডিগ্রি কলেজ, দাঁতন টু, পশ্চিম মেদিনীপুর, ওয়েস্ট বেঙ্গল, ফর অ্যাকসেপ্টিং আওয়ার ইনভিটেশন টু ডেলিভার দ্য ফার্স্ট লেকচার অফ দ্য অনলাইন লেকচার সিরিজ। আই কনভে মাই থ্যাঙ্কস টু দ্য পার্টিসিপেন্টস, ডিপার্টমেন্টাল টিচার্স, টিচার্স অফ দ্য কলেজ, নন টিচিং স্টাফ অ্যান্ড ইচ অ্যান্ড এভরি মেম্বার অফ দ্য একাডেমিক কমিউনিটি অফ দ্য কলেজ। স্পেশাল থ্যাঙ্কস টু দ্য মেম্বার্স অফ দ্য অ্যালামনি অ্যাসোসিয়েশন অফ দ্য ডিপার্টমেন্ট অফ ইংলিশ ফর দেয়ার লাভ অ্যান্ড রেসপেক্ট, মোটিভেশন, সাপোর্ট, এনকারেজমেন্ট অ্যান্ড কনস্ট্রাকটিভ ক্রিটিসিজম। ডিয়ার পার্টিসিপেন্টস, উই অল নো দ্যাট দ্য আউটব্রেক অফ কোভিড-19 প্যান্ডেমিক হ্যাজ সিভিয়ারলি অ্যাফেক্টেড অলমোস্ট এভরি সেক্টর, পার্টিকুলারলি দ্য এডুকেশন সেক্টর। দ্য এনফোর্সমেন্ট অফ দ্য কান্ট্রি ওয়াইড লকডাউন ইন ইন্ডিয়া ফ্রম মার্চ 2020 had badly affected the academic activities, physical and mental health of the students. With their institutions shut down for indefinite period, with the loss of their opportunities to mix and share their experiences, ideas and feelings with their friends, dear and near ones, the lives of the millions of students have gone topsy-turvy during the pandemic. Despite the fact that the educational institutions are trying to survive the crisis with the technology and digitizing the teaching learning processes, we should not forget that technology is not an unmixed blessing for the students of a developing country like India. In a society already divided along the lines of class, caste, gender, religion, language, and many other invisible lines of divisions, the introduction of online mode of education has unfortunately made us familiar with another form of division, the digital divide, with huge number of students deprived of the benefits of access to the modern technology. But unfortunately, the alternative to this is still not visible on the horizon. With the number of positive COVID-19 cases rising every day, the situation demands all educational institutions, educators, and learners to adopt technology and improve their digital skills in line with the emerging global trends and realities in education. Seva Bharati Mahavidyalaya was established on 17th July 1964 and it was established by Dr. Pobitra Kumar Sen, an eminent educationist. The above purpose was to cater to the need of higher education of the students of SCST dominated, underdeveloped and socially unprivileged backward rural area of Jhargram subdivision of Arsed by Midnapur district. Empowering the poor and academically backward people of Kapkadi and its adjoining areas was the sole aim and objective of founding the Seva Bharati Mahavidyalaya. Our vision has been to transform the Mahavidyalaya into a center of excellence in the arena of higher education and contribute to the inclusive development of the country by generating quality human resources. The Mahavidyalaya aims at holistic development of the young learners and hopes to mold them into young citizens of the nation who are dependable, honest, committed, and possess a sound value system. We believe that education is an ongoing process. It cannot stop even during the time of pandemic. Keeping in mind the academic well-being of the students of the English department of the college, this is our humble effort to organize the online lecture to cater to the needs of the students in this hour of crisis, when they are home locked and when they cannot attend regular physical classes. I ensure that the lecture will be profitable for everyone, particularly for the students of the fifth semester under CBCS choice-based credit system introduced by Vidyasagar University from the academic session 2018-19. The topic of today's lecture is African literature, with special focus on the two short stories. One is A Collector of Treasures by Bessie Head, and another is A God Who Can by Ama Atta Aidu, both included in paper CC11 of BA English Honors Syllabus of Vidyasagar University. Now let me introduce today's speaker, Dr. Ujjwal Kumar Ponda, to all of you. Dr. Ponda is a brilliant scholar and an excellent speaker. Dr. Ujjwal Kumar Ponda is now an assistant professor in the WBES and head in the Department of English at Government General Degree College, Danton 2, which is affiliated to Vidyasagar University, Midnapur, West Bengal. He did his PhD on the works of Seema Sini and Philip Larkin from Vidyasagar University in 2017 and has widely published in many national and international journals and books. Some of his important publications include a chapter entitled Tropical Diseases and Helpless Colonial Responses, Medical Humanism in Green's Journey Without Maps, and Farewells, The Siege of Christopher, published in the Imperial Maladies, Literatures on Healthcare and Psychoanalysis in India, 2017, by Nova Science Publishers, New York, USA, and Sense of Place, a Humanistic Geographical Approach to the Themes of Place, Memory, and Displacement in Bob Dylan's Songs, in Rupkotha Journal on Interdisciplinary Studies 20 in 2007. A monograph written by him is in press. He has presented papers in many national and international conferences, seminars across India. With these words, I request Dr. Ponda to kindly begin his lecture. Dr. Ujjwal Kumar Ponda.
Thank you, Sumitra. Thank you, Sumitra, for inviting me. And a very good morning, everybody. Sumitra has already confirmed my audibility and visibility. Am I still audible and visible? Please confirm before I begin with it.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you, Sumitra. And thank you for inviting me as the speaker in your online lecture series that begins today. And before I begin with the lecture, I want to convey my sense of gratitude to the Department of English, Seva Bharati Mahavidyalaya, and the principal sir for organizing this particular online lecture series. And today, this lecture, as Sumitta had already insisted, this will be more like a classroom lecture, not a very scholarly kind of lecture, because it is actually meant for the student, particularly the students of fifth semester. The syllabus of current CBCS syllabus that includes the African literature. And there are two short stories, one by Bessie Head, and the title of the short story is The Collector of Treasures. And another short story, The Girl Who Can, and it is actually written by Ama Atha Aitu. And my lecture will focus upon the feminist perspective, which is present in the two stories, and how the female writers, Ed and Aitu, they actually subverted the patriarchal and sexist assignations of gender role, or some stereotypical assignations of gender role through their stories, and how these two stories, they become a kind of mirror of the patriarchy, which is very much present in the African society from the time immemorial, and which actually continued even after the political freedom from colonization was achieved. Okay, now two writers under consideration today. The first one is Bessie Head, and the second one is Ama Atha Aitu. They are two very famous writers from the sphere of modern African literature. And they are actually very significant voices from the perspective of women's studies in Africa, as far as literary representation of gender is concerned. Okay. Now, Bessie Head, she was born in 1937 in South Africa, and she died in 1986, as you know. And from that point of view, sometimes there is a kind of confusion about her nationality. Somewhere she is referred to as a South African writer, and somewhere she is referred to as a Botswanan writer. Because Bessie Head is a South African writer, or maybe called a writer from Botswana, because she grew up in South Africa, but from 1964 onwards, moved to Botswana and continued to live there and obtained Botswanan citizenship later. Now, as we have already pointed out, she was born in Pieter Maritzburg, South Africa. And there is a very interesting fact related to her birth, that she was born to a white woman and a black man. And she was born in 1937. The time frame is very important, because in 1937 in South Africa, when it was the heyday of the so-called apartheid or racial hatred, it was almost unimaginable that a white woman is marrying a black man, because it was totally illegal at that time, because interracial relationships were illegal because of racism, because of apartheid. But somehow it happened, and Head became a marginal ethnic identity with a mixed color. She was half white, half black, as a result of miscegenation. Okay. Now, in 1937, when it was quite unimaginable that a white man or a black man, they are actually trying to trying to marry a black woman or a white woman, then this kind of relationship actually gave birth to Bessie Head. And as a result, she had to grow up as an adopted child, and her childhood was a very unhappy one. Okay, her mother became mad, and she was actually staying in a mental asylum. So all those things not very important here in the context, but we have to know the initiation of Bessie Head and the context of his of her life, which actually produced Bessie Head and her literature. So Bessie Head, she became an orphan and grew up as a kind of mixed woman with mixed heritage. Okay, and this mixed heritage, it actually contributed to her ideas about racial and ethnic identity, and it also formed her broad outlook towards humanity in general. Later, she became a journalist and was involved in the Black Liberation Movement. And when she was living in Durban, she came across people from Indian community, and she became very interested in Hindu religion. And she was also a very ardent follower of Mahatma Gandhi and his non-violent philosophy. And as a result, she became a writer influenced by different ideologies: the religious ideology, the political ideology, the Black Liberation Movement. Okay. And she became involved or joined politics as an active member of Pan-Africanist Congress, or PAC. And she joined a few weeks before that party led a mass protest in Soweto, Sharpeville, and the infamous Sharpeville massacre ensued. Bessie was arrested, and after she was released from jail, she was very disillusioned because of the political failure and migrated to Botswana. And Botswana, in those days, it was not a free state. It was also a part of South Africa, which was being run by an autonomous body. And then Botswana was known as Bechuanaland Protectorate. So she went to Bechuanaland Protectorate and began to live there in Siroe village. In Siroe village, she began to live there and started writing novels and short stories. And before that, she had also a kind of failed marriage. So she was a disillusioned woman and went to seek refuge in the simplicity and remoteness of an African village. Okay. And there she began the practice of literature and wrote many important novels of modern African literature, like When the Rain Cloud Gathers in 1964, Maru, which was published in 1971, and A Question of Power, that was published in 1973. And this present book, the present story, that is The Collector of Treasures, it was actually the title short story of her famous collection, The Collector of Treasures, and other Botswana village tales. The, all her stories and novels, they are set in Botswana, particularly in the Seroye village of Botswana. Then now, it was a kind of first-hand introduction to the writer, Bessie Head. And then we are coming to the kind of writing Head used to practice. And when we take the names of the writers like Head or Aidu, naturally, the feminist perspective comes to our mind. Now, before we go for a kind of examination of the presence of feminist ideologies in the Collector of Treasures and the Girl Who Can, we must have a kind of primary idea of what feminism is. The feminism is basically a cultural theory, as we know, and it analyzes the prevalent gender roles as they are represented in cultural forms. May it be literature, or it may be cinema, it may be advertisement, it may be broadcasting, or anything which are actually cultural representation of our society, or a kind of cultural representation of the traditional gender roles in the society. So why feminism actually came to being? The feminism came to being because it actually tried to locate a kind of assignation of stereotypical gender roles, and it was assigned by patriarchy. And these stereotypical gender roles actually thought women to be a kind of sex or sexual identity that is meant to be confined within the four walls. And patriarchy, very cunningly, they projected women to be inferior than the male sex. Now, women are inferior to male sex, and from that point of view, patriarchy actually accepts male sex to be the first sex or the primary representative of the society, and female sex to be the second sex or the secondary identity in our society. This is the Now, this stereotypical assignation of gender roles, the stereotypical assignation of gender roles, as it is there in our society, and this stereotypical assignation of gender roles is controlled by patriarchy, controlled by gender discrimination, and controlled by sexism. I'll come to the point, what does it mean by the term sexism, because the term is there in our title today. Now, the patriarchy or patriarchal social order, they relegated women to some pre-assigned societal roles. What are the societal roles? Homemaking, childbearing, taking care of the male main folk of the family, and at the same time, other many household works. That is a kind of control, according to the feminist critics, control of the patriarchy on the inferior, so-called inferior, second sex of the society. And with these roles, the patriarchy or the sexist society, they actually try to take hold of the gender identities. Okay. Now, feminism is both a political stance from that point of view, and at the same time, it is a cultural theory, as we can understand now. And it focuses on gender as a subject of analysis when cultural practices as a kind of platform to demand equality or rights or justice for women comes to the very surface. And feminism, by doing so, it draws a kind of link between the representation of women in art or literature. At the same time, it refers to the real material conditions in which women live in our society. As I have already pointed out, feminism's key assumption from that point of view is that genders are predetermined and the women are trained by patriarchy to fit into those roles. So what are the roles? I have already told you, roles like taking care of the elderly, main folk of the family, continuing a kind of patrilineage by childbearing, breastfeeding, etc., etc. And this kind of treatment, it actually took a kind of negative turn with the passing of age, and women became oppressed and repressed through the patriarchal ideologies. Okay. Truth to tell, feminism's key political stance is this. So what is the key political stance? The inequalities that exist between men and women are not natural but social. Okay. Because it is actually dictated by men. It is actually controlled by men. It has been given a structure by men in the society. So women, they have no identity of their own. What they will do, how they will behave, all these things are being dictated by men folk of the society. And it is called patriarchy. Othoba jake amra boli pitritantra. Banglay jake amra boli pitritantra. The pitritantra I thik kore day je how the women in our society will behave. Okay. So therefore, the subjugation of women or repression of women, this is not actually natural. But it is actually determined by the society and the societal structure from the very initiation of society itself. Okay. It is not preordained, but created by men so that they retain power. Okay. And religion, family, education, and the art and knowledge systems, they are all social and cultural structures that enable the perpetual reinforcement of this inequality. Okay. Now, I have already pointed out this kind of subjugation or repression that actually led to the advent of sexism. Okay. The sexism is a much recent term, but it came on the heels of feminism. I have already used the term sexism in my title. Now, we must have a kind of idea of what sexism is. Okay. The term sexism features largely in modern feminist discourses. Okay. So, what is sexism? Sexism is a kind of prejudice, or rather a kind of discrimination based upon a person's sex or gender. Okay. It can affect anyone, but it primarily affects, from that point of view, it primarily affects girls and women. It has been linked to other stereotypes and gender roles, and may include the belief that one sex and gender is intrinsically superior to another. Okay. And extreme sexism may foster sexual harassment, rape, and other forms of sexual violence, as we can well understand from this particular definition. And these things happen in the present stories, both in the Collector of Treasures and in The Girl Who Can. Although in the Collector of Treasures, the expression is very bold, very, very straightforward. And in The Girl Who Can, it is there, but the expression is much controlled. Okay, that is. But they do almost the same thing. So what is the point here? They actually deal with the sexist African society, where women, they are doubly dispossessed. So why women are doubly dispossessed in Africa? Because in the colonial African society, as exponents of black people, women were under the colonial depression, but at the same time, they were dominated by the male folk of their own society. So they are colonized both politically and from the perspective of their gender identity. From that point of view, African women may be called doubly dispossessed. Dispossessed by their racial identity and at the same time dispossessed by their gender identity. So these things are important for an understanding of the two short stories. I'll come to the stories shortly for a better understanding of these particular ideas. Okay. Now, the term sexism, it actually first appeared in print in an essay called On Being Born Female. And the essay was written by Carolyn Bard in 1968. Okay. I'm quoting from the essay written by Carolyn Bard. And the name of the essay is On Being Born Female. Okay. There is recognition abroad that we are in many ways, I'm quoting from the text, there is recognition abroad that we are in many ways a sexist country. Sexism is judging people by their sex. When sex does not matter, sexism is intended to rhyme with racism. Sexism is related to the concept of racism. If racism stands for hatred for the blacks, sexism refers to inherent hatred of male folk for the female folk in the society. Okay. And this particular aversion, this particular hatred actually goes into the making of women as a kind of second sex, as a kind of suppressed or repressed human identity. And it is continuing for the very ancient time. Okay. Now, sexism is thus a kind of result of patriarchy. Now, we have to know the meaning of the term patriarchy also. to understand how it operates in our society. Now, the term patriarchy has come from the Greek word patriarches, P-A-T-R-I-A-R-K-H-E-S, which literally means father of a race. Patriarches, the Greek word, it literally means father of a race or chief of a race. And patriarchy, therefore, means the rule of the father. Again, some authors trace the etymology of the term patriarchy to the Latin words pater, standing for father, and arch, standing for rule. Rule of the father is patriarchy. Now, patriarchy, therefore, attempts to perpetuate a kind of patrilineage, or by doing so, it subverts the claim of matrilineage. So what is patrilineage and what is matrilineage? Patrilineage is a kind of continuation of the rule of the father. And by continuing the rule of the father through generations, they are continuously trying to subjugate the right of women in the society. The value of women, the crucial role that women play in our society. Okay. Now, this sexist tendency to perpetuate the patrilineage also assigns some stereotypical gender roles to women, as I have already pointed out, and they remain confined to the household roles like homemaking, childbearing, breastfeeding. And in polygamous African society, women are traditionally treated as sexual objects. And in modern day Africa, there is a growing tendency to break free from these sexist prejudices and to subvert the patriarchal assignations of gender roles. And this particular thing happens both in the collector of treasures and in a girl who can buy idol. Okay. The two short stories under consideration today, in a way, they will prove the veracity of this argument that women in post-colonial Africa, they are trying to break free from the so-called patriarchal assignations of gender roles. They are trying to assert their identity in front of the world in a more potent way, in a more powerful way. Okay. Now, Black liberation movement that took place in Africa, that also, in a way, disregarded the claim of women in society. And colonization also played a very big role in the relegation of women to the secondary status in society. Because in ancient Africa, men and women, they enjoyed equal right in the society because the society was agrarian society. And what colonial education did to the African men, that they received European education, and from agriculture, they actually converted to industries, administrations, and etc., and began to earn a lot of money, which women did not manage initially to do. Okay. When Africa, in the pre-colonial time, when Africa was an agricultural society, then men and women, they worked hand in hand to actually make their livelihoods. They worked hand in hand in the fields, and they we are equal to each other from that sense. They worked in the household and at the same time they worked in the field. But after the introduction of colonial education, in the neo-colonial situation, African men, they received European education and they began to hold posts in the administration, in the colonial administration and then in the neo-colonial administration. And they began to be salaried. And they actually earned a lump sum amount of money as their salary. And women did not manage to have administrative jobs initially. And this actually strengthened the rift between men and women in African society to a greater extent. And this particular point has been dealt with by Bessie Head in The Collector of Treasures at length. Okay. Now, the common denominator is the concept of gender in these two short stories. And women are subject to control and the oppression on the basis of their gender. This is something that functions to unite women across divisions of race and religion and common experience of oppression and based upon their gender identity, they try to protest against the cause of their oppression. They try to assert their gender identity in front of the world. Okay. Now, as we know, that literary representation of gender, it has a kind of linear progression. And according to Ellen Showalter, the famous feminist critic, according to Ellen Showalter, the feminist criticism may be called gynocriticism, as we know. And Ellen Showalter coined the term gynocriticism to refer to a form of feminist criticism that focuses on the works written by women. Okay. And she divided writings by women in three broad time frames in relation to the thematic representation of women identity in literature. Okay. The women's writing, according to her, can be divided into three phases. Okay. 1840 to 1880, when women tried to emulate masculine tradition. 1880 to 1920, when they protested against patriarchal form and values. And 1920 onwards, when they voiced their own perspectives. And she refers to these three phases as feminine, feminist, and female. And the two texts under consideration, they refer to this particular idea in different ways. The Collector of Treasures, it may be called a feminist text because here the woman protests against the subjugation. And The Girl Who Can, it can be considered to be a female text because it seeks a newer identity for African women in modern day Africa against their traditional gender roles, against their predestined gender identity. Okay. Now, coming to the texts, this particular short story that is Collector of Treasures, it is set in post-colonial Botswana and deals with the life of D.K. Lady Mokopi, as we know. And D.K. Lady Mokopi and her estranged husband, Gary Sago Mokopi, who actually leaves his wife and three children, and D.K. Lady has to take care of them as an independent woman by sewing clothes, while Gary Sago sets off in his pursuit of sexual gratification with other women. Interestingly, Gary Sago is a man educated in the European way, and he actually holds a very important position in the independent Botswanan administration. He's an educated man, but education has not enlightened Gary Sago. He actually behaves in the traditional African way of treating women as a kind of object of sexual gratification. Okay, and at the same time, he actually disregards the role of a father, the role of a husband. Okay, and with money, all he wants to do is to enjoy life carnally. Okay, now he sets off in his pursuit of sexual gratification with other women, and D.K. Lady gets on very well with her neighbors, Paul Thebolo and Kinalapi. Thebolos are very kind to this woman, that is D.K. Lady. But Gary Sago, however, is jealous, very jealous of the relationship between Paul and D.K. Lady. When D.K. Lady is in need of money to pay for their eldest child, Benabot's school fees, she invites Gary Sago over to her house to discuss it. But he is under the impression that she wants to have sexual intercourse. D.K. Lady, however, takes the knife and cuts off his genitals. And for this deed, she is imprisoned for life. And in jail, she befriends three women, especially Kibone, who have come to the jail for the same crime. So this is the story of a woman's ultimate revenge on the cause of her oppression. Okay. Now, what actually dominates the plot of the story is the concept of phallus. The concept of phallus and the concept of phallocratic man. Okay, the Gary Sago Mokopi is a phallocratic man. In the sphere of gender studies, phallus is much more than a biological male organ. Okay, the how was the man killed? The man was killed, the husband was killed by the oppressed wife when she slits off his phallus by a sharp knife. Okay. Now, Gary Sago is a phallocratic man. He actually is the symbol of male sex by dint of the pride of his phallus bearing. Okay. Now, this phallus has turned into a kind of metaphor of male supremacy, and the male is here a kind of phallus bearer. It propagates the idea that women should be satisfied with their status of a second sex because they lack a phallus. Now here, symbolically, D.K. Lady murders her husband. When she murders her husband, She does not stab him or poison him. She could have poisoned him because he was drunk and he was sleeping. She could poison him, but she does not poison him. She does not stab him. But what she does, she just slits off his phallus, the symbol of male authority or oppression. And by doing so, she asserts the ultimate victory of female power. That is the point. Okay. And in course of the story, Bessie Head time and again, in a very bold language, she time and again refers to the phallocratic or phallocentric society and the tragedy of women. It actually comes from the phallocentrism of African society in general. I'm reading from the book for a better understanding of this particular point. Okay. She writes, there were really only two kinds of men in society. I'm quoting from the story. The one kind created such misery and chaos that he could be broadly damned as evil. If one watched the village dogs chasing a bitch on heat, they usually moved around in packs of four or five. As the mating progressed, one dog would attempt to gain dominance over the festivities and oust all the others from the bitch's vulva. The rest of the hapless dogs would stand around yapping and snapping in its face while the top dog indulged in a continuous part of orgasm day and night until he was exhausted. Okay. Now, no doubt, during that Herculean feat, the dog imagined he was the only penis in the world and that there had to be scramble for it. That kind of man lived near the animal level and behaved just the same. Gary Sego is a man, is a phallocratic man for whom women have nothing to provide but sexual gratification to man. And he is a man who is all penis, quote unquote, according to Bessie Head. Okay. He needed little analyzing as he was responsible for the complete breakdown of family life. And by doing so, African families are breaking down. Actually, the story begins in medias res when we see that Dikeledi Mokopi is actually being taken to a jail that is at a very long distance from her village for the crime of husband murder of her husband. And when she goes to the jail finally, she actually meets other women in the jail who are there for the same crime. They have also killed their husband. So this kind of phallocratic men, they are very frequent in African society. And they, according to Bessie Head, are men who are not a body, but all a phallus, all a penis. It's a very bold language, but it is the idea that she is trying to establish. Okay. So they never think of their family. They never think of their responsibilities. They never love their wives and their children. Okay. So he had little individual freedom to assess whether these traditions were compassionate or not. They demanded that he comply and obey the rules without thought. But when the laws of the ancestors were examined, they appear on the whole to have been vast external disciplines for the good of the society as a whole, with little attention given to individual preferences and neat. The one such man was Garesagu Mokopi, the husband of Dikeledi. Okay. Now, Garesagu Mokopi is a man who was enlightened by so-called European education. But this actually had not changed his outlook towards women. And he actually uses women as the medium of sexual intercourse. And finally, when his wife actually cuts off the very symbol of her malehood, it becomes a kind of revenge of a repressed gender identity on the cause of that oppression. Okay. Now, there is another man in the story, Paul Thebolo, who is the very vice versa of what Garesagu is. Paul Thebolo is an educated person. He is the principal of the local primary school, and he is a responsible family head. He loves his children. He actually loves his wife very much. And he believes in the equality of both the sexes in the society to be natural, to be the way of emancipation. So European education, it had some positive result on some of the male members of the society in Africa, but most of them were stuck to the traditional African belief that male are habitually polygamous, and they have all right to use their phallus as the symbol of their male authority. Now, this kind of idea, which is a very bold idea and written in a very bold language, it has a rawness, rare rawness, with which Bessie Head has protested against the cause of oppression, the phallocentrism of African society in The Collector of Treasures. Now, what is the significance of the title Collector of Treasures? What are the treasures? According to Dikeledi Mokopi, treasures of our human life are related to love, sympathy, compassion, okay, etc. Some surer human feelings, some very noble human emotions. He was searching for those particular emotions, noble emotions or feelings all through our life, but was denied time and again. Okay. And when she met Kenelepi and Paul Thebolo, she discovered those treasures in them and was ready to sacrifice her life for them. And when she finally came to the prison house, she met Kiboni, another girl who has been imprisoned by the court for the same crime, okay, or killing of the husband. She also finds a kind of rare compassionate attitude towards human beings in her also. And from that point of view, she befriended Kiboni within a second. So all through her life, she was searching for respect, for honor that a human being will give to another human being. But she was denied time and again. She had lost her parents at a very early age. She was raised by a kind of cruel uncle. And then this man, Garesagu, he actually completely disregarded the value of a human being in the family and used her as a kind of medium of sexual gratification by a kind of phallocratic by exercising a kind of phallocratic superiority. Okay, now this particular idea that this girl was a collector of treasures, or she was a collector of love, collector of happiness, collector of compassion, but ironically, she was denied all these things all through her life. And finally, she had to kill the cause of that denial, her husband, Garesego, to achieve that treasures, love, compassion. When there is no oppression, there is always a source of achieving compassion. And it happens. It happens in the story towards the end. Although she is in jail, she is imprisoned, she finds a rare kind of compassion in the inmates living with her. And finally, she again begins to collect treasures. Treasures not in the material sense, treasures in the abstract sense. Okay. Now, this particular short story is then a feminist protest against the very cause of male oppression. And very symbolically, that revenge takes place when the wife actually cuts off the genitals of the sex addict, sex maniac husband. Okay. And by doing so, she actually disregards the phallocentric supremacy or phallocratic supremacy of men in the African society. Now, coming to another short story, that is The Girl Who Can. The Girl Who Can is also a very important short story from this point of view, because in this particular story, the traditional assignations of gender roles, it plays a very important role in this particular short story also. Now, Ama Atta Aidu, she is a Ghanaian writer, and she became the education minister of Ghana, and she was actively involved in politics, and she was actively involved in women rights movement in Ghana. At the same time, she is known for her famous novel, Our Sister Killjoy. Okay, and Our Sister Killjoy, this particular novel was published in 1977, and The Dilemma of Ghost, it was published in 1965. And Ama Atta Aidu, she was born in Salt Pond in Ghana in 1942. Now, Girl Who Can, it actually protests against the patriarchal or sexist ideology, not in a very violent way, not in a very bold way, not in a very raw manner, as we have seen it in The Collector of Treasures. Here, she refers to other possibilities of African women which they can achieve apart from the traditional assignations of gender roles, like childbearing, breastfeeding, taking care of the male counterparts in the family, etc. Okay. And the story, very importantly and very interestingly, it centers around the construction and debunking of fertility myth. Fertility is a very important idea in culture. In culture, women are often referred to a particular identity which is very much akin to the mother Earth itself. The mother Earth is a symbol of fertility because it actually provides us our livelihood, And when the earth is fit for cultivation, the earth becomes a provider. At the same time, women, according to the patriarchal ideology, women, they have the one and only purpose in this world, in this society, that is to be fertile, that is to continue the patrilineage, that is to continue the generations of human beings by childbearing, by taking care of children, by providing them food, etc., etc. So when a woman is not fit for conceiving children, she is treated with negative comments, or she is treated with negativity by the patriarchal society. And the root of patriarchy is so deep in our world that even the women in our society, they begin to think in the similar way, that women have only one role to play in this world, and that role is having children, breastfeeding them, etc., etc. And from that point of view, the patriarchy has referred to some bodily attributes which are actually signs of a good woman. A good woman must be very plump. She must be very healthy. She must have big breasts. She must have a kind of fat hip or a kind of plumpy leg. And if they do not have them, they must be treated with rebuke, because they may not be turned into a mother, a very good mother, or a very good sexual companion of a man. So how women will behave, how will they look like, how will their bodily attributes will appear, all these things are controlled and dictated by patriarchal ideology in a way. And in this particular story, Adjoa, the little girl who is the speaker, first person narrator of the story, she is a girl who is devoid of such patriarchal expectations about a female body. She is very thin. At the same time, she has a very thin and long legs. And it is a matter of concern for her nana or her grandmother, maternal grandmother, and her mother, because they are afraid that Adjoa may not be a girl fit for having children in future, because she's so skinny, she's so unlike women. Okay, but it will prove to be beneficial from another point of view, and that is very interesting. And the story begins very symbolically referring to the fertility of a particular place. Fertility of a particular place. And we'll come to understand that this fertility of a particular place is integrally related to the fertility of women's body. Fertility of a female body. I'm reading out from the story. The speaker is Adjoa, a girl of merely 7 or 8 years of age. Okay, and she lives with her maternal grandmother and her mother, because her mother is estranged from her husband. And it was a wrong marriage. What is the cause of that estrangement? It is not clear, but somehow that man has left her and his daughter for another woman. Okay, very much like Gareth Sagomokopi in The Collector of Treasures. Or this kind of polygamous behavior on part of male protagonist or male characters in the society. This is very frequent in Africa, because African men, they take polygamy to be very natural, and it is a part of African culture itself. They marry 3, 4, or 5 times sometimes. Okay. Now I'm quoting from that particular short story. That is, they say that I was born in Hasudji, and it is a very big village in the central region of our country, Ghana. The place is Hasudji, and it is actually a very big village in the central region of our country, Ghana. They also say that when all of Africa is not choking under a drought, Hasudji lies in a very fertile lowland in a district known for its good soil. Maybe that is why anytime I don't finish eating my food, Nana says, "You Adjoa, you don't know what life is about. You don't know what problems there are in this life." So the narrative technique, it actually chooses a narrator who is innocent, being a little girl. Her point of view of the society is free from the politics of gender or cultural upheavals, etc., etc. She does not know. She does not have any idea of such differences in the society. But we can well understand why her mother and her grandmother are so concerned about her physique, because she is thin. At the same time, she has long and skinny legs and a very light hip. And these things we can easily relate to the infertility of women from the stereotypical belief propagated by the patriarchal society or sexist society. So she does not understand what is the problem with her legs, thin and long legs. But we can understand why the mother and the grandmother, they are so concerned about her thin and long legs. Okay. Now, I am again quoting from the story. Like all this business to do with my legs, I have always wanted to tell them not to worry. Okay. I mean, Nana and my mother, that it did not have to be an issue for my two favorite people to fight over, but I did not want either to be told not to repeat that, or it to be considered so funny and anyone would laugh at me until they cried. After all, they were my legs, very important. They were my legs. When I think back on it now, those two, Nana and my mother, must have been discussing my legs from the day I was born. Okay. What I am sure of is that when I came out of the land of sweet, soft silence into the world of noise and comprehension, the first topic I met was my legs. They are very much concerned with the long and thin legs of Adjoa. Okay. That discussion was repeated very regularly. Nana said, "Ah, you know Kaya. Kaya is the name of her mother. I thank my God that your very first child is female, but Kaya, I am not sure about her legs." And Nana would shake her head. "Mami bolto, mother, why are you always complaining about Adjoa's legs? Tumi tar pa niye eto chinta korcho keno? Tar pa shuru ar roga hotei pare. Seta niye tumi eto chinta korcho keno?" Nana said, they are too thin and I am not asking you. Nana has many voices. There is a special one she uses to start everyone up. Some people have no legs at all. My mother would try again with her small courage, but Adjoa has legs. Nana would insist, except that they are too thin.
And
also too long for a woman. Kaya, listen. Once in a while, but only once in a very long while, somebody decides nature, a child spirit mother, an ancient accident happens, and somebody gets born without arms or legs or both sets of limbs. And then let me touch wood. It is a sad business. And you know, such things are not for talking about every day. But if any female child decides to come into this world with legs, then they might as well be legs. These are not legs of a woman, of a girl. What kind of legs? What kind of legs? I knew from her voice that my mother was weeping inside. Nana never heard such inside weeping, nor that it would have stopped Nana ever if she had heard it, which always surprised me, because about almost everything else apart from my legs, Nana is such a good grown-up. In any case, what do I know about good grown-ups and bad grown-ups? How could Nana be good grown-up when she carried on so about my legs? All I want to say is that I really liked Nana except for that. Nana, I keep saying, if any woman decides to come into this world with all her two legs, then she should select legs that have meat on them. Reconsider the very... The legs must have meat on them. Okay. With good calves, because you are such legs would support solid hips, and a woman must have solid hips to be able to have children. So Nana and the mother of Adjoa, they are driven by patriarchal ideologies, or they have taken it for granted that a woman's chief role in the society is childbearing. So she must be plump, she must have a good hip, she must have a very fat or good calf to be a good mother, to be a very good sexual partner of a man. But this idea is erroneous, because women may be very good in other spheres of life also. But patriarchy had made even women believe that these are their natural roles, nothing else. If they are not good looking, they do not have a good physique, then their life is a kind of failure. But Adjoa had a kind of leg that can be a gift for any athlete. This is the irony. When there is a school competition in the district level, she actually comes first in every running competition. Okay. And the sports teacher, the others, they are quite impressed by the capability of Adjoa as a kind of sprinter. And they are optimistic that this girl will one day represent the country in great or big sports events. And when Adjoa finally goes to play for her school in the district level, and she comes first in each and every running events, and she was awarded with big medals. The Nana and the mother become extremely glad, and they began to celebrate for the first time. And they did not repeat the same thing, same concern about the thin legs of Adjoa after that. Actually, finally, the confined women who were made to believe in patriarchal ideology, the confined women like Nana and Mother, who believed in the in the society, assigned roles for the women in the society, they finally come to understand the crucial truth that a woman can achieve a lot of things in their lives, except homemaking, except childbearing, except breastfeeding. She must not have a kind of good physique, a plump hip, or a well-structured calf to be a good mother. Because despite being a good mother, she may be a very great success in other spheres of the society. Adjoa may not turn into a very good mother, a very good sexual companion to a man, but she will come out with flying colors as an athlete, because she does possess the legs of an athlete. And this particular event, this particular idea, it has been very beautifully presented by Amma Atta Aittu through the narrative voice of a little girl who does not understand why the mother and the grandmother, they are so happy. Why are they so elated after she wins medals in the district sports? But we can well understand that these women are finally relieved of the burden of patriarchy, and they now begin to believe in the new possibilities opened up before a woman in the second half of the 20th century. So they may go beyond the sexist assumption of some gendered roles assigned for women in the society. They can do things which are suitable for them on their own, because the woman's success is not only in being a good mother or being a very good companion of a man. So winning the medal in the playground becomes the potent tool of protest against the assignations of traditional gender roles in Amma Atta Aittu's short story, The Girl Who Can. Now, in this way, both Aittu and Bessie Head, they try to subvert the sexist stereotypes which are very prevalent in African society in their own different ways. Okay. And there are very remarkable similarities between the two stories, because they deal with the lives of women. Okay. And they deal with ideas against the sexist or patriarchal assignations of gender roles. At the same time, they actually concentrate on the lives of women in little African villages, but their lives become a kind of microcosm of the macrocosm. Okay. And that's all I wanted to discuss today with you. Thank you for your patience. And I'm going to end here. Okay. Thank you very much. Okay.
Thank you, Dr. Ponda, for your wonderful presentation. And there are some questions from the students. The first question, see on the screen. The question is made by Karishma Khatun, a student of our department. Can you read the question?
What is the main focus of African feminist writers? Actually, feminism in Africa, it came late because it came in the 1970s or 80s after the so-called colonial rule was over. And the countries, the little countries or small countries, they got independence from the clutches of colonization. And women in Africa, they tried to fight against a kind of dispossession, which was doubly significant because they were blacks in a white dominated society, and at the same time, they were women in the male dominated society. So, to establish their separate identity, they had to do away with all these barriers. And it was more difficult for a black woman to assert her identity than a white woman. Okay. Sumidha, is there any other question? Both the stories, the men leave their families. Why they do this? Is this a custom in their society? Not a custom in their society, but it happens. Because African, traditional African cultures, they are often polygamous. And it is not a crime to marry more than one woman. And that is why sometimes cultures across different countries in Africa, they actually face deteriorating family relationships even today, okay, because of this emphasis on polygamy to be very natural to male members of the family, okay. Anything else? Sumidha, is there anything else? Yes.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Ponda, for your excellent, brilliant, and wonderful presentation. And I'm very much confident that the participants will be hugely benefited by the lecture as they come to learn a lot of new things, new ideas from your lecture. Now, once again, thank you. And let me express my profound gratitude and sincerest thanks to you for giving us time and sharing with us your views on this highly sensitive and relevant aspect of the African literature and cultural representation of women in Africa. You have rightly pointed out the politics of representation of gender, sexuality, identity of African women in the patriarchal society. The role of women in a typical African patriarchal society, marginalization of the women by the males, quest for the newer gender identity, phallocentrism, all these highly relevant issues have been analyzed in a very, very fascinating and superb manner. The elements of resistance and rebellion are very much strong in the writings of Desi Het and Amma Atta Aidu, as they fiercely subvert the traditional roles assigned by the patriarchal society in the African context. They challenge the patriarchal mode of representation with a renewed vigor and defiance that are an integral process of decolonization and Black liberation movement. You have, in a very precise manner, presented before us the whole history of anti-colonial resistance in Africa and how the African writers assert themselves in a bold manner. African literature is now globally acclaimed as a part of the vibrant world literature because of the invaluable contributions made by a galaxy of such brilliant writers. Your discourse on the African literature, particularly the writings of Desi Het and Amma Atta Aidu, is really a food for thought. Thank you once again for your excellent presentation and for offering us with a wonderful session. Now, I want to express my gratitude to Mr. Subarna Roy, the Honorable Administrator of the Governing Body, Dr. Vinod Choudhury, the Vice Principal of Seva Bharati Mahavidyalaya, and also the patron of this online lecture series. And thanks to the participants, the students of the department, the teachers of the college, and thanks to everybody who helped to materialize this event. Last but not the least, my sincere thanks and appreciation goes to all the participants, including teachers, students, participants, friends across the globe who chose to be live with us with great interest and made this lecture a grand success. Thank you, Dr. Ponda. We will meet again very soon. Thank you all.
Thank you, Samita. It was really an enriching experience for me. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay.